Then search through the information to evaluate the hypothesis. that if the initial information is more ambiguous, the auditor will, the occurrence of auditor's final judgment will be low. To test the hypothesis, also did an experiment. The participants are 94 mainly staff auditors from a larger public accounting firm with an average of 7.56 months of auditor experience. I'm not sure whether only one to spend this much time in the experiment, they will not get more reward if they get higher accuracy. So this is not the situation there. It may not be the situation in the real world. If in the real world these two groups can spend more time and they might get the same occurrences that are obtained by the third group. If so, we can only conclude that the initial information only affects the time efficiency, not the recurrence.
Isn't this kind of his first conclusion, tautology, meaning a self-fulfilling prophecy, meaning if you get more difficult information to analyze, you find less things with it? You don't have to agree with me. Saying that is, if I get more complex, mixed up, ambiguous information, I find less results out of it. Wouldn't that be obvious?
Yes, maybe if the time is limited, because I have to drop.
I heard your comment about time, and I totally agree with you. Time limits in experiments. Very often you do it in class and you only have a certain time limit or etc. Are a form of manipulating the results of the experiment. Although researchers very often don't think of that. I mean, I ran a lot of experiments in my early days and I knew very well the effects of the time limits. And so you are very insightful that the therapy. But the point here is you offer ambiguous information. If the conclusions are buried there, the more ambiguity you have, more difficult is to find the conclusions, right?
Yes.
So would you publish this paper?
If they can tell more about the experiment, maybe.
I would publish it. That's why I put it in the list. I would publish it, but I think it's tautological. I think it's
yeah. And the other thing to some extent is obvious. The more ambiguous information you get, the more difficult you can find the information.
this term ambiguous is very ambiguous, right?
Yeah.
And what do you mean ambiguous? I have too much information, is that an ambiguity? Or I have effects that are very large, or I have effects that are very small, or I have the wrong variables. So it's.
Yeah, say, say define the, what is ambiguous information.
Yeah, you know, this is trying to mimic real life. Real life is complex. So there is ambiguity by definition. Okay, so I'm not saying we shouldn't publish this, I'm just saying.
I think I had enough.
Andrea, how many days you spend analyzing that data?
Just analyzing the data, like 2 weeks, just on that. And then coming up with the literature even longer.
Yeah. Well, you know what she, what verbal protocol analysis is, you take record what the person is saying, and then you try to classify the utterances in some kind of behavior. Getting data.
Right.
Okay.
Yes. You classified
it
into 4 different categories.
Yeah. I seen actually the first study like that. This is Simon and Newell technology. Simon, no, Herb Simon, Nobel laureate from Carnegie Tech. He was basically a behavioral scientist. And so he developed this methodology of recording and people thinking aloud and recording that and trying to classify, because you couldn't put pearls on people's brains. Then Mark and Biggs, Stan Biggs, did the first paper applying that to auditing, and got published in JAR. But I was there when Ted Mark had the paper rejected by JAR, and we were in a cocktail party in a conference with the editor of the journal, John Mikdokic at that time, a mythical guy, and they were really yelling at each other about the paper. And Ted and Nick was saying there are 4 samples that you have there. And Ted, the sample is 1,000, I don't remember the number. And the question is, the 4 that he was saying was 4 partners that had been taken. And Ted was saying, I had 1,000 uteruses that I classified. So what is the sample? The number of subjects, or is it the number of utterances being classified? And to credit for Nick Dokic, he changed his opinion and published a paper. And Dix and Mark was one of the top cited papers for many, many years.
And since then, there have been a pile of papers that way.
And what we did in the KPMG study there, we replicated that study, that methodology in general, but instead of having a guy think aloud, meaning he would get a case, like a preset case, read it, and think aloud about it. And in this case, we had a manager and a partner discussing brainstorm in a particular audit. And then what we did, we take recorded that entire conversation, and then we used the voice transcriptor to transcribe some of it, and then we used another voice transcriptor to improve the transcription. And there we are with that paper. And maybe you should share the current version of the paper for them to see how difficult it is.
It's difficult, but it's
very insightful.
And Chow Chow, you've seen the thing that she's doing. She's trying to convert that into the civil support system, so the evidence that we learn. So it is practical if you want to do it. Anyway,
thank you very much.
Most of you were not here, not most of you, five of you were not here last year, but Bill Kinney was here last year presenting. Did you see him?
No.
Oh, who saw Bill Kinney last year? What did you?
He was great, wasn't he?
Yeah, well,
Bill Kinney was probably the prime researcher and artist. And I like him especially because, although he never done this, he has a great opinion about Continuous Orbit. I like you a lot. And he's retiring from Texas this year.
Yeah.
But I think he's still there as honorary or whatever. But he's, you know, we already discussed one of his old papers. This is another paper of his, and his work is fantastic.
Yes. So this paper is talking about the attention directing analytical review. In the counting process, in the auditing process. He used the case study to classify the question. So the first one, what is attention-directing analytical review? So it always can be used in the two stages of the auditing process. The first one is at the planning the beginning of the auditing plan to check whether book values warrant more than ordinary auditor attention. And the second use is at the final review, whether the auditors obtained sufficient competent evidential matter and thus have an adequate understanding of any seemingly unusual fluctuations or relationships in the final audit balances. And the background of this paper is analysis of ratios of account balances is a widely applied attention directing principle. But little is known of the ability of ratio analysis to identify material monetary error in actual account data. So such knowledge is very important for evaluation of ratios analysis as a tool for designing efficient and effective auditing procedures. And the purpose of this paper is to test if the analysis of ratios of account balances is useful for designing auditing procedures. And this paper used a case study method because the authors think that the material in the auditing procedure is different from different industries, different companies, and it's disaggregated data. So they think if you apply the study, the method to a lot of companies, it will be very difficult to get the data. So they think the case study is a good method to test this question. Although somehow you don't know how much this result can be generated. paper, selected attention-directed analytical review procedures are applied to actual monthly account balances for a single firm over 4 audit years. So it means applied for 48 months. And the case form. The case form here has relative good internal controls and uses a periodical comp system for inventory and cost of sales. And also, independent personnel make test accounts of about 1/12 of the inventory each month to estimate the total ending inventory. And there are no changes of accounting methods of the 5-year period. They test for 4 years, so 1 year is another year is a benchmark. And each of the 5 years was audited, but monthly balances were not audited individually. So they use monthly balances. So they list some often used ratios. First one is receivable turnover, and the second one is inventory turnover, and the third one is cost of sales ratio, and the fourth one is accruals ratio. So they also test two types of errors in this paper. The first one is purchase on account, but it is not recorded. The second one is fictitious sales on account recording. So reasons to test the errors mentioned above is that these errors are among the most frequently encountered in practice. And also these errors, the affected accounts typically require adjustment, like these four ratios also require adjustment. So here there's some result. For here is some their theoretical their theory. So if the fictitious credit sale entered, then the receivable turnover will be up. And if the omitted credit purchase occurs, the inventory turnover, the cost of sales will go down and the accruals will go up. So investigation rules. This investigation rules is talking about the auditor's investigation rules. The auditors often need to trade off simplicity against accuracy. And three rules are applied to the same base data. This talk about the authors always use the three rules to test. The first is a test statistic. It's a percentage change rules. It's you choose a benchmark and to test if the percentage of change is huge. And the second is the statistical rule, require the calculation of the standard deviation of the prior year's values. So you consider the changes in the prior year. And the third way is the pattern analysis. It's based on the first two analysis. So it's just a pattern of fluctuations identified by rule two to indicate which error if it seems likely. So here is some theory of the application of rule three. So you can see if you find some results, yes, in the first two rules, then you will have a yes in the rule three. Then if you have a yes, you need to test. And the yes means there may be some mistakes in the financial report, so the auditors need to test. Here the result is for the error equals to 0.5 of materiality. It means there are little errors, if there are little errors. You can find the panel A means that this is error one, type error one, but you can find that authors think most of the errors are type error two. So it means if there are little errors, this method is useful. for this, for auditors to test whichever is stated in the financial report. So this is the error for two times materiality. It means if there are a lot of errors in the financial report, then you can see that these numbers has decreased. So the quality is the quality of auditing report will be increased because there are a lot of errors. So it means if there are a lot of errors, the auditors will be more possible to find the errors. So here are some conclusions of this paper. The first, the reliable attention directing analytical review procedures require a fairly large ratio of accounting error signal to natural variation noise in the base ratio, just like what we see here in these two. And patterns of deviations from expectation over several related ratios may be useful in identifying the cause of an error. So it means rule three is based on the findings in rule two, rule one and rule two. And the third finding is a preliminary explanation analysis that reverses possible errors can be useful in preliminary evaluation of a suggested explanation of a deviation from the expectation. So it means, although there may be this method used in auditing process may be sometime may be useless, but it still makes some progress in the auditing procedure. So, yes. Any questions?
How would you do this differently if you want to do it?
I think maybe can apply to a big number of companies.
Not just a case.
Yes, you can just divide your samples to different industries, I think, maybe. But yes, the how to choose the materiality is a difficult question.
Have you seen the work that Keqing, Xuan, and Yunsen are doing on ratios?
No.
Have you guys seen it?
I think if we add more ratios to the rules, and then we'll get more results. That's what I think. Because
why would you add more ratios?
To get a better result, I think. The rules. They have the three rules, and then what I see, it's they're not related. The three rules that they included in the paper.
How about you, Nuruddin? What would you do?
If aggregation can be applied here in whether in periods or in business segments to produce more detailed results.
Anyone else
with some idea of what you're doing this paper? What's the problem with adding more ratios to this?
This paper is published in
1987.
Yeah,
87.
It's very old.
Is this because it's old, it's bad?
No, it's not
about
bad.
About your professor.
Says that you could use multiple variables to get the ratio.
How would you expand this? Andrea, any ideas? Think about clever.
Original papers, they were basically the generators, analytical procedure. Now, this is 87, no internet. Okay? And there was internet, but no use. In the early 90s, the World Wide Web came in, and so the internet showed up. What would that help? Remember, clever? So there are other forms of evaluation that don't come from financial statements. And that's what we have been started talking about, exogenous data.
Just for your clarification, exogenous data is tertiary data. Like, for example, what are people saying in Facebook about this company? Or what was the weather in the stores and how did that affect sales? That's what we call predictive analytics.
Any other ideas of what could you link to this? I talked about weather, and I talked about social media.
Google search queries.
Google search queries, or for example, divide your data if you have that data in zip codes and see if there was a correlation with local macroeconomic variables. We did that, we did AUBEC in 25 years ago, 6 years ago. So there are other forms of data that are coming up that are confirmatory in nature of different accounts. The one problem about adding ratios, and we have been trying that with the Keqing study, is that many of the ratios are self-correlated. Okay,
yes.
You put too many ratios in there,
yes.
They basically measure the same thing.
Yes.
That's the major problem with adding a lot of ratios.
But Professor, here it's like for balance sheet he had two ratios, and for the income statement he has two ratios. Could we add like more, one or two?
I'll give you homework.
Thank
okay,
you.
The homework is you next time come and tell Andrea will remind me. Tell Andrea what other ratios you would use. Very simple. Take you 10 minutes.
I'll do that.
Okay. And then let's see if Keqing and Xuan, what do they think about it?
Okay.
Or Yunsen.
All right. We'll do that. For this paper or the other one?
For any paper. For this kind of problem.
This kind of
problem. This paper is... Everything is problematic here. Why? Because it's one case that they're using.
Exactly. That's what I was saying about the rules. They just.
Yeah, and they present two like correlated, they are considered totally not independently. So I think for Ivy's question, it's hard for the managers to control every ratio in this paper. So I think it is not a problem.
Why managers should control the ratios?
Yes, I think maybe if managers knows the authors are going to use these three ratios. So
you know, managers use the earnings to, you know.
Yes,
both, yeah,
yes.
Earnings management.
Yes, so
right.
What I mean is
so
that.
Still.
Yeah.
So they can manipulate the
exactly,
financial
right.
information that go into the ratios. That's
exactly.
That's the issue,
yeah.
Which is why we should look for
exactly.
a different method to do more effective analytical procedures.
What's the difference between manipulation and fraud?
Manipulation may be not fraud.
Right.
Manipulation may be no fraud because FASB standards allow you a lot of leeway.
Yeah.
You can do a lot of interpretation, you can change your expense. Every single account, except maybe cash, you can manipulate in some way. And what actually, if you can think about this, you think that after a few years of manipulating, the only manipulation you can do is fraud. Because you kind of stretch it, and then there is nothing less to be done. Okay, and companies like WorldCom, Enron, they really stretched before they went to the, even Enron is questionable if they ever really defrauded. Enron had something like 600 accountants, CPAs on board, and they were very sophisticated, and they looked at all the angles. For example, they had these SPEs, special purpose entities, that they linked one to the other. And clearly that was designed for changing the view of the results. But it wasn't totally clear that itself was illegal. Actually, it was not illegal. Now, WorldCom, they actually did defraud. They really put numbers that didn't exist in their straight off. And one accountant in there actually resigned rather than put it in. Okay, who is next?
Harish. To develop a peer selection scheme that partitioned public companies into different groups based on their financial reporting characteristics. So the basic idea is if you have two kinds of companies with different financial reporting, they would be classified into two different groups. And if you had a lot of companies with very similar financial reporting practices, then they would be classified into the same group. And traditionally, when we want to select peers or classify peers into groups, we rely on static industry classifications. This is generally done in traditional classification schemes like SIC boards or things like this. But this paper has a dynamic peer selection because the peers change from period to period, because each period you apply clustering methods that select financial ratios which are representative of firms' reporting characteristics. And how you select those financial ratios and why you select financial ratios to cluster will be something that I will talk about soon. So what is the motivation for this paper? So generally, it is very useful to gather firms with similar characteristics in one place. for a variety of reasons. So one reason is our type of research in accounting always wants to find control codes, and they want to create matched samples and things like that. So if you can find clusters of companies with similar financial reporting characteristics, maybe you can base your hypothesis, and if your hypothesis is related to their accounting quality or the way audit reports happen in those companies, then you can look at clustering based on financial ratios, and you can create a match sample just to prove your point in your hypothesis tests. And it also has many applications for anomalous behavior. And something happened in year 3, 2, 4, 3, which was which is something you would not expect, because firm 3 was in the same cluster as firms 1 and 2. So in this paper, firms 1 and 2 are peers of firm 3. And if firm 3 is placed in a different cluster in a subsequent year, in the paper it says 5 years. So it's not 0, 1, 2, it's 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. But just for the sake of the example, if this something happened to this firm and it was not part of the cluster, then there could be many reasons for it. And if you can have this kind of scheme based on clustering, you can always observe firms that change clusters. And maybe you can say something about those firms because of economic conditions, management conditions. If you are doing an audit, it would be of interest to you to see which firms changed or came out of the cluster, because the clusters are based on financial ratios, right? So if some firm comes out of the cluster, that means there was something that was that changed with the financial ratios that it reported. So that would be of interest to an auditor. And applications for anomalous behavior, I think Professor Hussain does a lot of work in this area, where he tries to identify exceptions and things like that. So if you have firms clustered together and one firm suddenly moves out, then it could be easy for you to say that it was an exception if what you clustered on was a financial issue that auditors look at seriously. So that is a kind of simple example as to why this method is, why they studied this in the first place. And they also talk about existing classifications of firms. So these classifications, They are used predominantly in empirical research, and if you see any accounting paper or corporate finance paper, basically any paper in business that wants to classify firms, they usually use this one, SIC codes, and they also have started to use Pharma French industry classification. So the difference between SIC codes and Pharma French 49 industry classification is that the Pharma French classification just classifies the SIC codes based on risk characteristics. So you have the Pharma French model, which is book to market risk and high minus low and the typical market risk. So based on these three factors, they further classify the SIC code completely. And then you have, so these are the two predominant ones. Recently, NAICS and GICS have also started coming up. So the first three are very similar, SIC, Pharma French, and NAICS. But GICS is actually run by, I think, JP Morgan Stanley, if I'm not mistaken. I think they are one of the firms that manage the classification schemes or something like that.
Yeah,
I think it's in the paper someplace. I'll check. And so the problem, or the issue that they wanted to address by coming up with this clustering-based classification instead of these existing ones, was that these existing ones are basically used by researchers for when they try to control for things or things like that. But the purpose of these classifications was not just in the process. The purpose of the classifications was to provide statistical data. So some of the classifications are based on requirements for statisticians and not researchers. That's one of the arguments that they make in the paper to motivate why we would need a mechanism like this to classify instead of pre-existing mechanisms. So now, why would you want to base clustering on financial ratios and not something else? So this is an important question that they have to address in the paper, I think, because you cannot just arbitrarily say that I want to cluster based on financial ratios. So the reason is, so that there are many reasons. One of the two of the main reasons that they cite are, one is that accounting research has extensively examined the usefulness of financial ratios in terms of their predictive role as well as the descriptive role. And this observation is, I think a very good observation, because whenever you see any accounting paper that has any kind of predictive element in it, a key ratio that they use is ROA or something like that. So it makes it's a natural leeway into clustering based on financial ratios. And there's a lot of prior research that says that you can examine accounting ratios to find correlations between changes in accounting ratios and firm-specific events, like earnings management, mergers and acquisitions. I mean, there are many papers in corporate finance dealing with relations between, and accounting too, dealing with relations between accounting ratios and big issues, firm-specific issues, like corporate failure, bankruptcy, etc. I think there's an Altman Z-score model that uses financial ratios to predict the risk of bankruptcy.
So what's the biggest difference from this paper and like a professional that was like doing like propensity score matching?
Clustering, different from propensity score matching, and I'll talk about how clustering is done. So propensity, both have a difference. I'll tell you exactly how clustering is done with an example. And just have some patience. And so they also cite this one paper by Gupta and Hoffner in 1972, and they used several financial ratios to cluster firms into different groups. And their main result was that financial ratios are relevant for representing industry characteristics. And of course, if prior research finds that if you cluster on financial ratios, you can find that they are relevant for representing industry characteristics, then it makes sense for you to cluster on financial ratios. So there are some strong evidence and hypothesis about why you should cluster on financial ratios in the first place. And their research methodology, what do they actually do? So they use something called k-means clustering. So k-means clustering, and they base their thing, they base their clustering on four financial ratios, ROA, current ratio, asset turnover, and long-term debt over assets. And why do they choose these specific four ratios? So they're motivated by prior literature again. So there was a paper by Krishnan and Press in 2003, which used financial ratios. And then that suggested that these are some of the most important financial ratios. And so they used these four financial ratios to their k-means clustering. And then what they do is that they compare their method to the four classifications that I talked about before, the SIC codes, FF49, GICS, and NUICS. And they randomly select a target firm in each industry classification systems category for each year. Then they run a clustering analysis based on their k-means clustering using financial ratios. And all firms are partitioned into groups. So this is how they do it. So basically, in the beginning, you select a target firm and you look at it for a period of 5 years. Okay? And then you cluster in the, so your T is what you actually want to see. And you cluster in your T minus I, T minus 4, T minus 3, T minus 2, and T minus 1. So this will basically, like this is essentially the simple example done over 5 years. And then in the 6th year, you want to see what happens.
I
think had data from 95 to 2014. So they looked at the firms from, this would be 95, 96, 97, 98, 99, and then you can start with 2000. So I think that's one of the reasons for the paper, but there might be some other reasons. I think this was the one that you
mentioned. This is a bit arbitrary. I think that is, that is pile of studies that take time series and moving windows and et cetera. They, I think it's really a decision they make. I actually have a question that is precedes everything. Why do you want to do this?
Why do you want to cluster?
Why do you want to cluster?
So one reason could be just, you know, you want to assist our type of researchers. Because if you cluster, then they can see similar groups of firms. So if they want to run some studies, then they can run some studies based on characteristics like financial issues, and they can find data easily, right, if you cluster this way. The other reason is maybe existing classifications do not provide you all the information that you would want to run an empirical study. And maybe they have some kind of complicating factor. So for example, if you have, if you look at the SIC boards, and you look at CompuStat for SIC boards, versus if you look at CRSP for CompuStat for SIC boards, you will find that 38% of the time they are different. So if SIC boards and are different from in CompuStat and CRSP, and if you are a researcher, it is difficult for you to distinguish exactly which part, which database to use and what to use. So
I think that the SIC is really impressive is that not because of the SIC, it's because of the CIK. Because CIK changes, but GB key doesn't change. So I think that if you have to match the SIC based on the GB key and then come back to the circuit, it's going to be more.
Change across the years. That's what you mean.
No, CIK also doesn't change that much, but like GBK is much more stable. So
yeah, that might be the reason why it changes between databases. But if you're a researcher, it's very inconvenient for you if you decide to go for CRSP based on SIC codes. Maybe you get a different result versus if you go to CompuStat for SIC codes because you have different control samples.
Yes.
And that's what they say in the paper too.
Yeah, but basically.
But it's interesting that they change because of CIK.
Yeah, but can you once more explain that why we are using clustering here? Like, I'm a little confused. Like, I still think that these are like the same process that what we did with score matching. We didn't do like some stochastic.
Yeah, this is a camera. So it sits towards the end.
Yeah.
Well, I'm still at my beginning. I think what I asked is relevant to what you're asking too. I actually like your answer. I like the answer that this is to help other research. Okay, that's good part of the answer. Now, why do you want industry codes, whatever you do, to clustering and excellent? What's the purpose of having industry codes?
So I think one purpose is, again, from a research perspective. So for example, when you have the pharma French industry classification, they classify everything based on industry. So the basic idea is inside an industry, firms inside an industry versus firms outside the industry. There might be something that is that you miss if you don't control for industry.
Okay. You are even using the word industry. I am not talking about industry. I talk about classification of companies in groups. Okay, and typically, I'm totally right. Typically, people use industry as the comparison basis.
Yeah.
Okay, because can't think of anything else. Size of the company, and you compare a company with 10,000 employees with other 10,000, one is a consulting firm, the other one is an industrial firm, would be very different. Okay, but why create groups of companies? I'm just pushing you a little bit higher in this.
Your question is, why would you want to classify in the first place?
Yes.
Not what you would want to classify on the basis
of.
So, I think there can be, many reasons, right? So, one of the things is you want to determine the, so for example, you want to determine the determinants of success for a firm, right? maybe you want to classify successful firms and unsuccessful firms and look at the things that happen in successful firms which are different from the unsuccessful firms. So you can say something about why they are successful.
Okay, so you are classifying that because you want to determine the comparison basis,
yeah,
right?
You want to know
and
why something is happening to one specific group.
You want
the
comparison basis, and companies are very, very different, so you want to create groups of companies that are reasonably comparable for either you to do between group comparisons or within group comparisons, correct?
Yeah.
So don't say yes if you don't agree.
No, I understand what you're saying.
Yeah.
So if you have companies within the same cluster, then you can observe differences between those companies by looking inside the cluster. But if you want to compare two completely different companies, you would have to look at differences across clusters, not within clusters.
Okay, so we are in agreement on that part. So the idea of classification is an idea of comparison between similar companies within group or between different types of companies that behave very differently.
Yes, sir.
And you expanded my thinking of this. I was thinking only in auditing. And I was thinking that the reason why you create groups in auditing is because you want to do racial analysis, which is the most basic set of analytics, meaning racial analysis comes before any other audit analytic. And what you finish up is with these conglomerates. And I am sure you heard me say, consolidation is the best form of obfuscation. Correct? Because you finish up with a company that has a certain ISIC code or certain industry classification, but it's very different from the other ones. Comparing GE to anyone else is impossible. Comparing GM to someone else is impossible. Comparing Exxon, that's exploration, and et cetera, the smaller oil company, is very difficult. So the idea is creating groups of companies that behave and are similar to be compared for two purposes. One purpose is within that group, how well do they do, or certain characteristics they have, and between groups, how are the differences between these groups. And I think that's how they fell into clustering. Say, instead of using a pre-classified industry, or pre-classified grouping, let's group from zero and see what we find. And I think they excluded large conglomerates and et cetera.
They say that they have like 210,000 observations around that, and they excluded all the firms which had restatements or audit fraud restatements from the audit analytics database. So they also exclude those. But I completely agree with you. I think that the purpose of separating firms into clusters is so you wanted to know something and you want to see what is happening to similar firms versus firms that are not similar. So exactly what you said, Professor.
Yeah.
Just add a little piece of story. SIC codes went into companies that were created by, I think SICs are set up. Who sets them up?
The stock exchange, isn't it?
Yeah. And anyway, whoever sends it down. And then they don't change very often. A company like Intuit. Intuit is a company started with Quicken. Quicken, what is it? It's a software for managing your balance, to managing your personal finances. So they were classified basically software, financial software company. What happened with Quicken? They became a conglomerate of loan company, tax company, etc., etc. The SIC code did not change. Now Intuit sold Quicken, so they don't even have anymore. But that the SIC code, I think, is still there. And so that's a problem. And what it is now, Quicken? Quicken is actually an integrated financial company that does, you know, one of the largest loaners of the United States. And so that's the problem with SIC code. And that's the problem that they went this direction. You know what they are doing next? I wish Yusen said that he was going to show up, but we told him.
Yeah. Okay, Yusen, what are you guys doing next?
I think next time, just when Aaron is in his second paper, we are going to work with him and kind of test the class rate, the power of the class rate.
And they are going to try to deal with conglomerates, correct?
Right, exactly. So then to apply the three forms to the different sectors and
I suggested them to create what they call, what I call
virtual firms.
Virtual companies, which would be break down GE, main components, kind of fake up a little bit that some part of their statements and analyze them that way, and they came back with a different idea, which I think is maybe better.
And so one of the problems for you, Professor, SIC codes and their classification measures are static, which is exactly, I think, the point of your story, right? That they don't change over time.
Yeah,
but
listen, why did 5 years? Why did you guys choose 5 years?
The 5 years for classification.
Yeah.
Because we want to make sure that this company and peers are kind of stable, because if you can class your peers every year, it has kind of some dynamics to it. So when kind of stable peers, and with stable peers, they kind of better comparison.
This is what you would answer in a sentence, but you didn't answer the question. Why 5 years, not four, not six?
Prior literature do that with I just wasn't sure. Like from reading the literature, it was never clear to me like why 5 years is a benchmark. But
exactly.
I guess 5 years is good
so
enough.
So if you were going to do this, you would do 5 years, or would do three, or you would do six.
I think it's a personal choice. Quite frankly, you can do it for three, two, not two is I think. Three, 4, 5, 6 years. I
okay.
think data availability is also.
You are, yeah, no, that. Your first answer was data availability.
Yeah.
Because
that's
you saw the period and you figure out 3 periods here and etc.
Yeah. That was my guess. That maybe you waited for 5 years because the sample starts from 1995. So 5 years after 1995 is 2000. So you had data availability after.
Jensen, what would be your reaction to this discussion? What would you do in this discussion? With this discussion? Guys, it's something to learn. You hear a lot of discussion about something you did in a paper. Okay? Your way to deal with it is preemptive. Write a paragraph on the paper saying, based on past literature, we decided 5 years. And someone might want to study it to 6 and 4. That way, the referee is not going to come back and ask that question because you already dealt with it.
I just remember the one of the very first paper talking about the cluster talks about the years, but I just don't remember who writes this paper. But I know there is a paper talking about how many years you should use in clustering.
Actually, you are right. Availability is also a good point. Actually, we tried. If we use 3 years and the peers, we find very large population of peers. If we use 5 years, it's kind of a middle. If we use 6 to 10 years, we also try to have small, limited peers.
Not multi company cluster.
Yeah, actually, we tried 8 years and finally 5 years is the best option.
Okay, I want to continue discussing this, so let's have a 5 minutes hygienic break, and then we are back. Okay, welcome, sorry. Guys, sorry about, I never am late for class, you know that.
Yeah.
Had a meeting about
and multiple dimensions. And multiple metrics. So you can use Euclidean distance and Manhattan distance and many other things. And so this is how K-means clustering works. So this is just the Wikipedia site. It's a very simple example where you have K is equal to 3. So you can see the steps, and you can see how they form the new clusters every time. And this is actually the iteration. So it the iteration has 14 times, and you can see each time the clusters are getting separated in a better way. So that's just how the clustering actually goes. Just okay. So back to the research design. Okay, and then so another important question that the paper addresses is, how do you check whether your peer-based clustering, K-means clustering, is better than the previous classification schemes, like the SIC scheme or something like that? So the first method they use is within group dispersion, and I'll tell you what it means. So within group dispersion is basically this value V, and the idea is that if you cluster firms, firms inside the same cluster should not have a lot of variation in their ratios, other financial ratios. So they used four ratios to cluster firms in the first place, and then I think they have nine other ratios, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah. They have nine other ratios which they did not use here. And they want, they say that if 1, 2, and 3 are in the same cluster, then these nine ratios should not have too much variability for each of the firms within the same cluster. But if you have, but if you, if your cluster-based scheme is better, then the variation for these nine ratios inside the cluster for the cluster base should be less than the variation for these nine ratios inside this cluster for, let's say, the SIC ones. You understand? Yes. Okay. And then they do this for each of the classification schemes. So they use their, they compare their cluster base with the SIC scores, with the NAICS scores, DICS scores, and pharmacology industry scores. And this is basically how they calculate the within group dispersion. So you can see the formula is basically B is the B is group as variance VI, NI is the number of companies within industry I, group I, industry group I, and capital N is the group. And then so the second way that they compare classification schemes is by using correlation with the peers. So they look at again, this is they use one of the nine ratios not used for clustering. So they use these nine ratios, not this one, right? And this is basically a regression test. So they take the they take one of the selected ratios, one of these nine ratios, as the y variable, and they take the average of the other ratios as the x variable, and then they calculate the R squared for cluster base and the R squared for SIC codes and other codes. And basically, the idea is the R squared for the cluster base should be bigger than the R squared for the SIC code if cluster base is preferred, is a preferred method of classification. Am I right?
Is he right?
Yeah. And so this is how they, so this is the within group dispersion result for the SIC codes versus the clustering mechanism. So you can see here that this is basically the ratio. So a ratio greater than one means that the dispersion, so a ratio greater than one means that clustering did a better job, right? Because there was higher variation in the SIC codes compared to the cluster. So that's the idea. So this RD is basically the ratio. A ratio greater than one is evidence that your clustering mechanism is preferred to your previous classification methods. And so this 12 means that, so this ratio is actually F distributed, and then they run their 2-tailed 5% significance level tests on it. And this 12 means that in 12 of these years, the ratio was significantly greater than one. So across these 15 years, I think 12 years had the ratios significantly greater than one, which provides evidence that their clustering mechanism is a better classification scheme compared to the SIC codes, where you use within group dispersion as a mechanism to measure the differences. And so they do it for each of the nine ratios that they take, and the nine ratios were these ones. So you have net profit margin, gross profit, etc.
So is this the one of the ratios you would add in the other paper?
I need three.
You
need to think about it, correct?
I have to read it, I think.
But this
paper is like, they add this ratio based on the frog deduction, right, Jensen?
Yes.
Okay.
From the frog picture, and also we do the experimental comparison to find each ratio which makes a significant difference between the two groups.
How did you do that?
S=5 to 88 ratios, and we select now.
That's good for my assignment. Thank you.
So this is just the. So the first one was SIC codes versus clustering, shared clustering mechanism. And the second one is the Fama French 49 versus the clustering mechanism. So in each of these tables, you can see, if you focus on the last row, you can see that there is a large number of years in which the ratio is significantly greater than one for each of the ratios that they selected. Okay. So this is compelling evidence that the clustering mechanism is actually performing better than the previous classification methods. If you measure it by within group dispersion. And then if you compare the R-squared, then it becomes even clearer, because you can just see that, so there is a very big difference between R-squared for the clustering classification and R-squared for the other classifications. 7% versus 0.7%. And the difference is significant across the board, except maybe some anomalies, one or two. And so they do it for all of these previous classification methods, and the conclusion is that they try to show that they try to classify firms based on cluster firms based on financial ratios, and they are successfully doing so because they provide some evidence about how their method is better than the other classification schemes used before. And for future research, I think there's a lot of scope in this, which they talk about in their paper too. Because if you have clusters based on financial ratios, I think one of the first applications that comes to mind is audits. So auditors always look at ratio analysis as an analytic method. And if you can just see clusters based on financial ratios, it would become very easy for you to do this kind of audit analysis based on these clusters. Also for anomaly detection, I think I talked about this before too. So you can look at fraud risk assessment, and you can cluster firms based on ratios that predict fraud risk assessment. And then you can look at different clusters within cluster variation, across cluster variation. So this might be one of the things that I think Professor Hussain is working on right now. And so this is basically, yeah, this is Wikipedia.
They submitted this thing to Verizon, correct?
Right.
So would you guys accept this?
It's from Jensen, of course.
Hmm.
I
don't
accept it.
So I think if you submit it to some regulatory body, that would be a great idea, because I think they're always looking for these kinds of things, like some regulatory, like the SEC or something. I don't know if you can go that far. But any kind of regulatory agency or an audit firm would very readily accept this methodology.
Yeah. They actually, KPMG is following this up for analytical review. They're creating a method. Let me ask you, however, you are referees on this paper. You all read this paper. You have to make some comments, correct? What comments would you make? What would you do differently?
Why you selected 5 years to cluster? Because in a lot of seminars, these kinds of choices I've seen, you know, people just, why did you do this? And if you just say it's an arbitrary choice, I don't think that's amazing. So maybe you can give them some kind of reason, like, I guess that it was because of data availability. Maybe you can motivate it based on some prior research a little bit more, maybe have like 2 or 3 lines about it in the paper. I think it's a good paper because it's not a typical, not like a typical research paper that you usually see where there's, you know, some research question and something like that. It's basically a methodology paper about how you go about classifying these firms based on financial ratios and clustering them. I think one of the things you could do is, so this kind of thing would be very useful if you had a robustness check, right? If you ran some study and you just wanted to do a robustness check. I mean, a lot of other studies in the end have a robustness check section. So that could be one of the things that you could include in your paper, not for the control variables that you already have, but just one or two lines about how it could be useful for robustness checks.
Sure, robustness check is one check.
Robustness checks that people do in empirical research. So if you have some empirical model, usually when you test this model and provide the results, there is a section at the end for robustness checks. And I think there you can motivate this, that for robustness checks, you can select a different, you can use this way to select a new group of control curves and see if your results improve. So that might be a nice way to go with it.
What else? What do you guys? Any other ideas here? Hey, we have the auto here. Give him some ideas.
Please.
He'll buy a cup of coffee. This car is not a very expensive coffee. He's a recent married guy, so you don't want him to spend too much money. Okay, so if you have any ideas, you send an email to Yunsen. CC me. Yeah, they are continuing their work. I actually have a very good feelings about this paper. I think we'll get it in Horizon, and we'll get some refereeing comments, and I think we'll get in. And it'll be a paper cited, because this problem of classifying things that are similar is a big problem. Although it has been done before, but I think this is new. Say that again. Any ideas? They are continuing this research. There'll be other papers out of this. So any ideas, they would have highly appreciated. And I might buy the coffee because he doesn't have any money. Or maybe he has too much money. He doesn't want to spend it. Okay, thank you very much. You want to go next to the coffee? So we are doing two new papers today as opposed to old papers. Knows this paper as well, correct?
Yeah.
And those two papers. One is setting up on the, what day is it? 11th of April? 11th of April, try to keep your babies on the tree. Because the level of paper, we have three defenses on the level of paper and one on the 16th. So, you're all welcome to come, and it's very good for you to see these defenses. Yunsen is doing, what time is yours?
Tiffany
Chen. Huh?
Tiffany and Chen.
Yeah. Tiffany, Chen, and you, but what time is you?
Both of me, 1 to 3.
Tiffany
is 3 up to 5 o'clock, and
Tiffany
is the morning time.
Definitely at 9. God willing. And on the 16th, we have Sophia.
So this is the time of, don't be impressed, this is just the time of the year everyone trying to get into May, into the May graduation.
Yes, man, ever?
Yeah, so, yeah. I didn't use this for students, and I've done Brazilian Lucas paper. I have some critical points, so I got
you add the economy data here, and then that's basically using the economy data coming from other external sources here. But deep learning and these steps, they are all like embedded in like SQLs here, like using like it's called like fuzzy data. Find that attribute to become black, to classify from black or white. based on when we just predict or classify those into a specific class, we need a membership function. And here, in the neural network, it could be like an activation function. But if you want to stick on this structure, actually, it's very it could be really hard to like customize this function itself. Like, did you use like sigmoid function?
Sigmoid and
yeah. So like actually those are really popular functions, as you know. But when you use membership function, what they do is that actually they customize that membership function. Like if they think that these market, let's just think about a market. So if they think that, oh, we need a market, a price discrimination in this market, then they could just customize the function. But actually those accounting data itself are really these kind of neural network steps could be really, really vulnerable based on what kind of like, function we're using. But when you just use like sigmoid or Gaussian functions or all of those like basic functions, we just get the like kind of like similar results from it because those functions look similar. But if we can define that, it could actually, the first best part is that performance will be better, but the performance does not mean the speed. It means the accuracy. So based on those functions, we can improve the like accuracy for predictions.
Traditional
fields like white sweater, could be classified as black, could be classified as blue, but black and blue are kind of exclusive. In this case, a frog could trigger a financial statement could involve more than one.
But that is the process of like, no, yeah, it could be, you're saying that, yeah, because like you say that black and blue steps, yeah, but my idea was like fraud and non-fraud, because like, fraud and non-fraud, yeah, so, yeah,
you
could
the
be
the possibilities.
Yeah, the possibilities, because when we say fraud and non-fraud, we can get a score from each attribute from it, and then after it classifies it based on those calling a function. So like membership function, so, but the membership function is kind of really, really complicated here because like all of these companies have different kind of like structures here. But if we can build those kind of like industrial, like typical kind of like membership functions, then it'll work much more better, I think. So the accuracy will be higher here. Yeah, but what you said, it's really hard to define the membership function, so it's gonna be tricky. But actually, this is like theoretical paper, so I think that it could be better to just add that stuff here. What you said here.
Yeah. Yeah, because of here, actually, the best part of here is that training, you got to pass like data from it, and then you can apply it to other like firms here. Private firms here, but actually, when you have the data set, the membership function, you can just same structure here. So I think that it could be better to use that. Yeah, this was when we was using key classifiers here. Actually, I'm just answer my question here. I was also thought that it was from the prior literature, but it's just from myself as an investor who has learning. We know that deep learning itself is kind of a black box here, but how we know that? We know that we can check the accuracy of it, but when we put in the data, which is like when we do like unsupervised learning here, the problem is that how will we prove that our prediction is right or not here?
How will we determine
the prediction?
Actually, I have a table on the
Yeah.
But
I didn't see. Because that is, but that is like kind of like comparing the result.
Right.
Yeah, comparing the results. But if I'm the firm, accounting firm, I put this in here, but I don't get the specific number for that firm, the accuracy is like 64%, or like
78%.
Yeah, accuracy. Yeah, we just got the score of it. We can't get a score of it, but actually the score of it, but we couldn't get the accuracy. And how would we trust that result if we are the firm? So,
the result of the learning neural network to financial statement.
fraudulent malicious events in the universe. Now, if our algorithm classifies all the malicious events as non-fraud, so what's the prediction accuracy? It's like 0.7%.
But actually, what you have to do is that you have to pick up the same number of that.
So we cannot. Other problem is, if you match the fraud with the same peers, number of peers, your reviewers doesn't have long discussion with this. The reviewers, the algorithms can pick the fraud from the same number of peers.
Same question.
That's not your real life. So in real life, as an auditor, you have to find the needle in the stack. Find the needle in the huge stack.
The needle in the haystack.
The needle in the haystack. You have to use the overall population. So that's the reason why we do not trust the overall prediction accuracy. Well,
so that's why it's kind of low.
Do you guys remember my positive and negative chart? Let me just use you for a second because that it clarifies a little bit the discussion. Actually, extends the discussion. But what is the factor? Good. They keep losing more and more weight.
Thank you.
Yeah. So this is your population of companies. You have to determine the threshold to define these are fraudulent companies, these are non-fraudulent companies. Okay, and you do the suspicious call, you might do it anyway. Okay, these guys here are reasonably sure they have, in his case, restatements and et cetera, so probably a large percentage of them are positives, meaning fraudulent, and then maybe a couple of them were mistakes. False positives.
No mistakes.
Huh?
As long as the court decide that financial statements is a fraud.
Still could be a mistake. Still could be a court could be wrong. Correct? Courts could be wrong.
Okay.
Unless Chairman Chi says that it is fraud, it is not fraud. Just joking. But okay. Now, that's not the big deal. The big deal is in this side. Okay? Just because a company didn't fall into a fraudulent category and was restated, how sure you are that they are not fraudulent? Okay, and so the ratio here of, let's say, false negative is quite high compared with the ratio here of false positives. And so what it finishes up that you're modeling after this, but you're missing this part here, and God knows if this is not much bigger than the positives that you found or not.
We don't know.
And so that's really the problem with all these studies. Problem with the studies is that the positives, you have a reasonably sure, you can assume they are positives. Okay? But the negatives might be more than the positives. And when you're modeling on these dichotomy, you're including them. And so that's the difficulty.
What about if it's maybe an error?
And I return this to it. You guys are the witnesses that I didn't steal his mic.
Yeah, we fit in the noise, like Professor Job there. We fit in the noise of the abnormal financial statements. Maybe they are fraud, but we treat them as non-fraud. And when we build the model will kind of fuzzy. We will kind of treat some financial statements incorrectly as non-fraud. So that's the main limitation of these types of study.
But if it's not non-fraud, do you consider it as an error, maybe?
That's not an error. That's not an error. Undetected fraud.
So maybe it's screwed. Why is it so high then?
It's a false negative.
False negative.
There are negatives, and there are positive negatives and
false negative, but no one knows.
No,
except
like
the CEO of the company.
And an error in the financial statement.
Yes, but the problem is that what you typically machine learning do is you have, let's say, those are the positive in this case is fraudulent. And then in order to develop your models, you match them with the same number so you don't have an unbalanced sample. And by doing that, you're creating an inherent bias in there. And that's what the problem that the bias, the noise, or in his terminology, the fuzziness index could be very large.
Yes, that's right. Yeah,
whatever fuzziness, I just made this word up.
The real problem is that some of you guys were at the AIS seminar last week. So I talked about the cybersecurity disclosure, which I'm doing with Dr. Now. Actually, we built a model, which we call a bag of topics. Like, we got a model to pick up the first specific disclosures from cybersecurity disclosures here. And we pick up the first specific disclosures here based on cybersecurity disclosures, and we wanted to predict a cybersecurity breach. But the problem here, we also have the same problem. Like cybersecurity breach, we pick up our data set is like 200 companies, 230 companies. We use every kind of news sources. And what we got was like 230 companies. But we are doing comparing with those whole entire decade, which is for 20 years, like it's like 60,000, 46,000. Yeah, so it's very high. But we wanted to, first of all, my thought was that we could just match those 200 companies with other 200 companies. Yeah,
it depends on your research object. If you want to find the difference of the parameters, the determinants of the cybersecurity breach, you can use match pairs. Mm-hmm. If you want to do a prediction, you cannot do the match pairs.
So it's based on the predictions and the.
Depends on your research object. Of you choosing the threshold determine the line of the AUC. The area under the AUC curve, that part we measure as the number of AUCs. So in that case, the line of AUC gives you all the numbers of positive, take four positive. Classify a fraud as non-fraud, that will cause 500 times that you classify a frog, a non-frog as a frog. So we change the weights of the classification and make sure make them kind of in weights.
Yeah,
kind of
as.
Yes, and there is some literature on exactly that, putting different weights on different outcomes. In this case is auditory error version. There is actually a paper, I think, by Hal, which is about the asymmetry of the auditory risk function. It's not Hal, but Hal,
thank you.
Thank you. Are you going to continue doing this work?
Yes. Let's submit it and see how the reviewers say.
Which journal are you going to?
I don't know.
We'll see.
They are going to be asking this question to him on the, what is it? On the 11th?
Yeah.
Where are you going to submit these things? I'm sure.
Well, we can discuss it.
We'll decide together.
Okay, so who is next?
We have Wu and Rin.
Wu?
Your choice. Who's the word? You seem to be working there. So now one device is not good enough.
Study on the use of process mining of event log as an analytical procedure in auditing, defined by the definition of PCOB. Analytical procedures are an integral part of the audit processes in testing for relationship that exists between transactions. And process mining is a method of understanding how a complex business process operates. So in this paper, the author uses process mining as a supplementary analytical tool for audit analytical procedure. And basically, this paper tries to explore whether the use of process mining adds value to audit analytical procedure. Specifically, this paper extends the prior works that focused on applying process mining algorithm to event log to attend to a European bank. Again, the focus of this paper is not only on reanalyze the data itself, but it tries to find whether process mining algorithm can add value to audit analytical procedure. Okay, in terms of process mining, what we try to analyze is what we call event log. It is the object to be analyzed in process mining techniques. The data recorded by the ERP system consists not only what we input, but also what we input is what we say the data, but also consists of metadata, which means the data of data. That is what we're going to analyze in process mining. There are four characteristics that can be extracted from the information system to build the event logs. First, activities. What kind of activities was done by the originators? Second, the process instance. Third, the origin protocols aims at focusing systematically on the transactions that warrant further audit investigation. And basically, this paper follows these six phases of process mining techniques. First, identify the designed process. This determines which activities need to be included in the event log. And the second, event log creation, that is what we are going to analyze. Third, process discovery. This is an important phase in process mining. In the phase of process discovery, it tries to find how the process is what's actually being done. And the fourth phase is role analysis. It enables the auditors to determine who took the action. The next one is attribute analysis. It allows a more subtle examination of activities. And the last one is social network analysis. It tries to find the interactions between people. Study location is one of the leading European banks. It is subject to Sarbanes-Oxley Act because of its operation in the United States. This study focuses on this bank's procurement process because this is one of the most typical process in most business. The data used in this fieldwork obtained from 2005 to 2007. Okay, first of all, let's identify the design process of the procurement activity. First of all, the purchase order should be created, and then the purchase order should be signed and released by the approver. That are the second and the third steps. When the purchase order is released, the goods are expected to be received, and the invoice of this transaction should be received by the accounting department, and finally the accounting department makes the payment. This is the design of the very standard activities that should be involved in the procurement process. However, it can vary from the design model as shown in this figure. For example, after the purchase order is created, changes can be made. Another example of the plausible process pertains to the receipt of goods in multiple deliveries. Thus, it is expected that extra invoice receipts. Okay, once the event log was created, a preliminary analysis ratio of this activity's frequency to frequency create Persian's order. Obviously, these six numbers do not match exactly. We can see that we have 26,185 create Persian's order activities. However, we have less frequency, that is only almost 25,000 activities of sign activity. So that means less sign activity. So that means not all the created purchase order were signed by the approver. So this number of these activities provides intermediate evidence that not all the purchase orders met the designed process. Okay. The next step is to analyze the number of variants. What is a variant? A variant is a unique sequence of activities in the event log. For example, the first variant here is this variant. Purchase order, sign, release, food receipt, invoice receipt, and payment made. There are actually more than 300 variants were identified in this field study. However, here we have only six most frequent variants shown in this table. After we identify all the variants, we can these variants are then compared against each other by using a process discovery algorithm to analyze the sequence of activities within the audit trial. This is the visualization of all of the core processes that correspond to the designed activities. As I have said, these are only the core activities, not all of them. From the beginning, create purchase order to the end, payment made. This visualization was created by the fuzzy minor analysis by default setting. If we change the threshold of the activities, we can see a more complex process shown in this figure. We can not only see the core processes, but also we can see the activities on the edge. The activities on the edge are called extra flows. These extra flows are the flows that do not meet the design process. Then it is valuable to analyze these extra flows. Okay, this is the analysis of these extra flows.
Just tell the difference between the two graphs. Can you just go back to things without it found there? This is really the process as it should be, with that little 1.1122 there that had a line threshold. if you change the parameter, this one says basically the fat lines are the former thing. You can say, show me the process where fats with lesser density are shown, you get this fat, this set of things. Okay?
Yeah.
So this is kind of going backward, looking at your log and coming up with a fat. Now, XNT, you could say my fat is, and it would be pretty much the one before without the thin line.
Yes, this table is the analysis of the extracts. You see, can I see the deviations? Deviation activities. Okay, let's take one group for example. Let's say the first two activities. These two activities are absent from Stein activity. That is, when the purchase order was created, it was not signed by the approver, but directly to the next step, the release. So we can see that verification required for obeying Stein activity. However, the author consulted with the bank's management that some activity could be omitted when the purchase order's value do not meet a certain threshold.
So you understand that the path of the transaction is dependent on the control rules in the company. One of the projects we are doing with the MATS project is basically payroll. And there are certain level of transactions only need one signature. Certain level of transaction needs seven signatures. And so you not only have to look at the PAT, but you also have to look at this nature of the transaction, volume, whatever defines it, has its own idiosyncratic rules. And for example, we found a whole set of transactions with no originator, no approval, and no purchase order. Turned out that some of them were basically leases, and the repayment of the lease every month. So every time that you pay for a lease, you don't have to go for an approval. Okay? And there are examples of that sort.
All right. And the next phase is role analysis. Role analysis explores the presence of metadata on activities or originators in the event log to examine the parts played by employees in the procurement policies, in the procurement process. This is the SOD policies in this bank. First, the sign and the release activities should not be done by the same person. Second, good receipt and invoice receipt activities could not be done by the same person. Third, release order and goods receipt activities should not be done by the same person. The first step of role analysis is to create a originator task metric that details the number of times an individual executes a particular activity. So this table is the originator task matrix showing which individual undertook which activity. However, this matrix provides only a preliminary analysis.
shows total activities and activities isolated by the process instances. For example, the number two originator did release activity for 11 times and sign activity for 171 times. But does this mean that this originator violates SOT control policy? Maybe yes or maybe no, because we cannot assure that these 11 released activities are the same instance as the at least 171 signed activities. So, a further analysis using linear temporal logic tool should be performed. After testing the entire population, it finds that the first two SOD control policies hold without any violation, but the third SOD control policy was violated for 175 times. Applying the first two components of this process mining yields numerous outcomes that warrant further investigation. However, a subtle verification needs to be done in this process mining application. The attribute analysis phase, there are two investigation was done. First, using software, they compare the references of the payment to the invoice references to check whether there is a company invoice for each booked payment. They find several payments without a corresponding invoice, several payments with no invoices, several payments with one, two, or three standalone payments. And the second analysis verifies whether the internal conditions of the organization are met when there is no sign variant. They found 742 cases that both lacked a this potential problematic activities should be found in their system, not
yeah,
in
the
yeah.
Yeah, because the logs are going
yeah.
from their system, and now the auditors check whether the procedures of performing tasks follow their predefined rules, right? And then they find a lot of exceptions. My comment is from another perspective, I say, to prevent this type of exception, maybe the bank should do some controls in their IT system.
Yes, I think that's because their system has a different threshold. So these activities are now possible. And by applying new process mining, they found this potential problematic transactions. Maybe in further investigation, their management would say no, these are not problematic because of the different set of thresholds.
You mean the threshold of transactions? The threshold of transactions about the bank?
Yes, because as I said, some transactions, some threshold folders cannot cannot meet the sign activities because they do not meet the direction.
So it would be the type of transaction, right? For example, if it's a transaction that is less than $5,000, then maybe it doesn't need to go through a signature process.
Yeah, sure.
Abby raised the issue. That's an issue in process mining in general. The issue is this audit methodology, or is this a way to improve process engineering? What do you think the answer to that is?
It's both. So this result that we get now can provide insight for both the auditors and also the bank, the ODT itself. Because from this result, we can see there are a lot of loopholes in their system because they let some orders like to be released even before someone signed it. So it means there are some loopholes in their system. And also, it also provides insight for auditors that there might be some issues going on there.
So you will be fired as an auditor because you are not supposed to give consulting. You are only supposed to review. Actually, your point is a very good point. Is process mining is very, very useful for the company to understand the quality of their processes. And when Sarbanes-Oxley came in and said auditors cannot do consulting, they were thinking about auditors going there honestly for more work and then not auditing seriously because they were like clients. Maybe Enron was paying $25 million a year in consulting and $24 million in audit fees. So they were making more money from consulting audit. So that was the purpose.
But for internal auditors, they can provide consulting.
So auditors can do whatever they want. Your point even for external audit, this is unintended consequences of regulation. I actually think, at the time that Sarbanes-Oxley came out with the independence rules for auditors, I thought they were a good idea. There are all these guys hustling for consulting and not paying attention to the audits, but in the Houston office of Anderson. Now, in retrospect, what that created is these auditors that have no technology in their minds. And just follow the rules. They, in the old time, they were implanting systems. They were thinking about different issues. And this is actually a new technology. Come in and has tremendous value from operations. Now, in general, clients want auditors to tell them to alter the problem with the operations. And very often in the management level, you say, improve this, improve that, and et cetera. But this is so useful that it could, and particularly the auditor charges more for doing
then it would be unacceptable. So this is actually something we have to change in the standards for this to be adopted. And actually you, whoever is doing this, will have to start thinking about what rules should be changed and what is the role of the auditor in this and how much can he advise management to change the process. But you see, this is again a rule generated in one context that creates a problem in a modernity context. Okay, I think we need to stop. Just leave to your, if you can manage this to move, can you leave to the, your next slide and just let's see if what else you have there?
Let's
go to the next.
This is the last phase, social network analysis. So in this phase, for example, in this step, it's exactly the three people that manage the SOD, the SOD control policies, and find the related people that interact with these three people. So there are three clusters here with total, in total 26 people involved in this violation of SOD control policy. And similarly, so that's there are some implications of research implications of process mining. The key consideration is how to increase the process mining techniques as an effective tool of in the audit procedure, audit and analytical procedure. And here are the list of findings of applying these process mining techniques in this field of study. We conclude this study finds that process mining is really the effective tool when it's integrated with audit analytical procedure. All right, thanks.
Okay, so it's lunchtime, so we stop here. I don't think we.